Hello and a very warm welcome to Great Principles. I am Seema Choria. Great Principles, an educational and interactive talk show that brings together best school leaders of the country. Our guest today has been an educationist over 18 years and has been associated with some top educational institutions in the country. She's a strong advocate for experiential learning. She's against any kind of child abuse and as a global goodwill advisor, supports this cause through her volunteer work. She strongly believes in the empowerment of women through education. Amongst her many achievements, she has been felicitated by Economic Growth Society of India with the Shining Image of India Award. She is also the recipient of Nation Builder Award by Rotary Club of Mumbai, Impact Award by Career Beacon, International Corona Warrior Award by Anti-Corruption Foundation of India, Acharya Vinoba Bhave Award, Sanjeevani Seed of Knowledge Award 2020, Visionary Principal Award and International Olympiad of Value System, Health and Wellness Award from Zenic Olympiad, to name a few. Amongst other notable mentions, she is honorary member of Women's Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, as well as Council Member of Maharashtra Education Policy Council. She is certified speaker and director of Global RK Courts Speakers Forum and honorary member of Alpha School of Life Skills and INAC.org and collaborator of CWSCIR. Welcome to the show, Dr. Shunila Joy Chauhan, Principal, Orchidsar International School, Malar East, Mumbai. Welcome to show, ma'am. It's an honor to have you here.
Thank you, Ms. Seema. It's really a pleasure to be here too.
Sure, ma'am. So to begin with, we would like to ask something about you and your career in education.
Okay, so actually I began my career as a teacher with City International School. Of course, before that I was teaching in tutorial classes, but my school education journey began with City International School. And there I was a founder teacher for 5 years. And thereafter I joined Vibgyor Group of Schools as an economics IGCSE and A-level teacher. So I did 5 years over there, and then I was promoted to their corporate office where I developed curriculum, and then later on joined the quality assurance team for doing these audits. And then came the next break, that was as a principal in Thakur International School, IGCSE and A-levels. I was with them for 3 years and then went on to a big brand, Orchids, the international school, where I've joined as the principal of Malad East.
Thanks, ma'am. So this has been like a journey of progressive growth for you.
Yes, actually it has. And so much have I learned on the way in so many different kinds of, the different profiles that I handled.
Great. So, ma'am, as you progressed in your journey and you are an advocate of women's empowerment, you know, there is hashtag she for she. When women help each other, incredible things happen. So on this note, I would like to ask you, why is women's empowerment important for development in India, and how can we empower women?
So the best way of empowering women is to educate women. Do not keep the girl child behind. When you have a son and a daughter, invest equally in both your children. The discrimination that children face, especially the girl child, at home begins at home. Do not listen to relatives who tell you that ye to apne dusre ghar chali jayegi. She'll go away. Yes, she will go away, but then she still carries your name, right? She belongs to your family and she will always belong. So that belongingness has to stay there. And that's how we educate our girl child, we educate women, and wherever possible, step in and try to make them at least literate. They should be able to sign on a bank account. They should be able to sign their checks. They should know what they are, saying yes to. So that can only happen when we educate women, because then they can at least have a job. They do not have to take the beatings and they do not have to take all the kind of other things that people usually give them. Maybe they underpay them for their work, even casual laborers. So all this can happen through education. So that's what I firmly believe in.
Absolutely, ma'am. It is very much required that, I feel that whenever as a girl myself, I always feel why the most organization enterprises are suffixed with and sons. Why can't they have and daughters also?
Yes.
So I think with women like you empowering and guiding everyone to literate girl child, this soon would be a reality that we will see and daughters soon. So this is what even I'm looking forward, and this is how I'm sure India will change. And you know, there is a change. We are seeing women in each field today heading strong and standing shoulder to shoulder.
Absolutely right. Now you see women in so many different fields. I was pleasantly surprised to even see auto rickshaw being run by a lady. She was driving it. And I felt, yes, why not? I was taken aback. But then, yes, that's what we need to see them, and we should not be surprised. That's the whole thing.
Absolutely. And I'm sure women are going to surprise many, many people in so many fields, and then their society gets used to this.
So I was telling you about the sharper philosophy that Orchids follows. So should I repeat that? S for self-discipline, H for hard work, A for applied science, R for research, P for physical fitness, E for exposure, and R is for reflective thinking. All these things mold a child, and they're all the different aspects that we need to nurture. We need to get in this kind of, you know, holistic learning in the child. Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful philosophy, and developing the child holistically.
Yes.
Going ahead, Ma, what is the difference between quality assurance and quality improvement in education? What controls do schools need to have in place to ensure this quality in education?
Yes, so the thing is that quality assurance is actually when you are monitoring, you know, and quality assurance is when you're monitoring. When you monitor, the aim is not to bring down anyone, but just to see that things are in place. Whereas when we talk about quality improvement, we need to see that as standards are being followed, standard procedures are being followed, whether it is in the monitoring of teachers, whether it is their building up their skills, the infrastructure, all these things. So I believe they go hand in hand, both quality assurance to see that it is being done and quality improvement to actually make sure that people are following all the SOPs or whatever it is that has been outlined. And I know that in each institution, there should be those, and they need to be monitored.
Great, ma'am. So your ma'am has been working in this area. So her very insight, she gave a lot of insights on improving the quality in schools and maintaining the quality of the education around. So ma'am, my next question to you is, how has virtual learning affected due to the pandemic? Academic progress had been affected due to pandemic.
Yes, to an extent, we do not realize how much it's being affected. Children are being affected because we are in the urban cities, we are in metro cities, you know, so here everything is happening virtually, and we only have a problem of screen time and, you know, the other technical part of it. But if you look at the rural areas where there is no device, how does the child study? So they have been impacted severely. Children have actually stopped learning for the past almost 1.5 years because they do not have the way to deliver that kind of education. And even if it is promised, it does not get to the grassroots. So that's a problem in rural areas. Urban cities have their own challenge with regards to timing. Parents work from home, investing in another device, also assessments as far as exams are concerned. Especially the key exams like the, you know, the board exams, they're affecting the standard, therefore. So they have been impacted. Otherwise, the education fraternity together has come together, and from everywhere, whether it is teachers or leaders, or whether it is all the online platforms that have been giving free services for so long to children. So all those things are there, and we do appreciate it. But children have been impacted because nothing, of course, does replace the, you know, the real time face-to-face interaction. And also the mental health of children have been affected because they are going through that difficult stage and social interaction. So all the things together have severely affected the, you know, learning, because the learning curve also is dependent on all these facets.
Absolutely, ma'am. Children are no doubt, you know, losing on the social question, and learning face to face is altogether a different experience, wherein learning is much better grasped by children. Because yes, teacher can, you know, assess them simultaneously, which is a little difficult compared to online.
True. See, there was a child who was, their parent was saying that, you know, he cannot hold the pencil and write. In other times, I would have said that, yes, don't worry, wait for 2 weeks and the child will settle down. Now, even when I tell them that, they know very well that they only have to make the child hold the pencil. So that's the difference.
Yeah, right, ma'am.
Yeah.
So going ahead, ma'am, why isn't there a single standard approach of education in India? What is the logic behind having these different boards and different curricula, and what are the views on one exam and one school?
See, definitely one exam, one school is something that we all would have. It's a very ideal situation. It would be much easier for monitoring. But if we look at the way they have all actually mushroomed, the things begins with how did they start? But I feel that with the NEP bringing in certain changes now, we are all looking at going towards that standardization of a one board. Ultimately, it will still take a lot of time. If we just manage to implement NEP, that itself is going to bring us to the level of at least getting, you know, the pre-primary schools under the mushroom of the school and then being integrated up till grade two. So that will also help, rather than having different people who are leading these schools differently. Each one has their own way. And so you have so many systems which can be so confusing for a parent, because if you're not into education, you wonder what is all this about, which one is good, which one is not, which one is a better system. So all these things actually do matter. Yeah, so one board, of course, is what we all as education would look at. But then, yes, the question mark would be the international boards.
Absolutely, ma'am. Hopefully schools implement NEP in the way it is designed, and we are definitely going to see a centralized model of study for all. Going ahead, ma'am, this brings to me to the section which is called achievement, ma'am. There are a huge list of your recognitions and awards that have been you are resident of. So, ma'am, you would like to know the one such accomplishment you're most proud of?
I'm proud of all of them, but I think one thing that I really liked was setting up the virtual lab, the augmented reality and virtual reality lab in my previous experience. So that was really a lot of back-end work. And I really enjoyed doing that, because it was something completely new. It was a completely new thing at that point of time. So that's almost 2 years ago now. So I'm really proud of that, because I was able to test it, was able to test the curriculum, see whether it is fitting the children, aligning it to the Cambridge education, testing it with small batches of children, teachers. So I'm proud of that, actually, because that was really a time when I also learned so much. It was not just saying it, but just really learning it.
Absolutely, ma'am. That really, you know, is a huge thing to have and to bring forth a new change, which is going to, you know, where teachers are so apprehensive of everything and bringing out the best of technology to them. So going ahead, ma'am, this brings to me the very, very interesting section of the show, which is called Rapid Fire Round. You have to answer in one word only. All right. So here goes the first question. Will we see better learning outcomes if NEP is implemented centrally across the country?
Yes, definitely it will, because I think it has a very broad vision, and so it will. We do see a lot of good changes coming up, and it's really welcomed by all. Yeah.
Going ahead, next question. Name a school principal you admire the most.
One or two?
Your choice.
Okay, so one is Mr. Rohan Bhatt and one is Dr. Seema Negi.
Great. So going ahead, ma'am, what is the right form of education? One model for all or individualized learning?
Individualized learning has to be there, because each child is different and they reach their level differently. So individualized learning within the broad spectrum of course, a particular thing. and let them achieve whatever they can best, because they will definitely excel then.
Next question, at what age should child start a school?
That's a very debatable question, because each one starts differently. But most of them nowadays start between once they are 2.5, children start with their, you know, play schools and then nursery and all that. So it's okay. Some child require, if people are in a joint family, they do not require that kind of socializing because they're getting, but then the others do. So, you know, it all depends. This is something which depends on the family.
All right. So going ahead, what do children need more today? A teacher, a friend, or a mentor?
A child requires a mentor who is their friend and is their teacher.
Beautifully answered. Going ahead, teaching is no longer a choice. It's a chance these days. Do you agree?
Sadly, yes, for some it's a chance, but it shouldn't be. It should be only if you be a teacher, if you have the passion.
So even in one word, ma'am has given us a lot of insights. This brings to me to the next question, which is called hidden talent. We heard you, we saw your professional side, ma'am. Now let's reveal what you personally like. What are your hobbies or sports you're involved in, and why do you enjoy them?
Okay, so not much time nowadays for hobbies, but I do enjoy swimming. And as a youngster, I used to play basketball. So I won't talk about that because it's all over. But yeah, swimming, I love going for long walks. I like to walk my pet. That's also a sport because it takes a lot of my time.
Great. So ma'am loves swimming. She likes to go on a long walk. So apart from, you know, handling orchids, the international school, and looking after daily course, she also tries to find time for her hobbies. Going ahead to the last question, which is also called viewer's choice question. This is something which is concerned with sexual abuse, ma'am, which is taking place within the family environment, which is a serious issue. And this often remains very hidden and, you know, very secretive, because it is very difficult type of abuse the child needs to face. So how do educators and parents make children understand the difference between good touch and bad touch? What should be the most appropriate course of action whenever such abuse is disclosed by a child?
So the first thing is that do not keep sex as a taboo topic to be discussed at all. Okay, when you do that, the child will hide what has happened to him, because it's a shame. That's what they will feel, because we've not talked about it. But if you talk to them age appropriate that this is wrong, no one has the right to touch you. So then they start getting aware. And then you can also tell them that if anyone tries to touch you, whosoever it is, you have to inform me. You have to inform your mother, your father. You know, you have some secret people who you assign for that. And they are the ones who are safe. And preferably, it should be just left to the father and mother, maybe grandmother, something like that. And remember, boys and girls are both abused. So let's not just think about the girls. Also remember the boys. And it's during events like weddings and all that, when there are lots of people, when predators actually strike and abuse children. And sadly, many of them are family members.
Yeah.
Yes. So that's when we have to make sure, once you come to know, please do not spare those people, because they need to be exposed and told what is right and what is wrong. Because it's not right. The child will be scarred for life. You need to deal with it. And it's you who has to deal with it. If you come to know, you have to deal with it. As a teacher, if you come to know, inform the parent. Many times it is teachers who come to know because the family does not have that kind of option at home to discuss all this. So the teacher has to inform the principal, who informs then the calls for the parents. So that needs to be done. There's no way that you can bury it and forget it because of family honor. Because if the person was so honorable, they wouldn't be doing this in the first place.
Yeah. Okay. So ma'am, how do we teach our young children, you know, about good touch, bad touch? It's kind of difficult to open up with this topic.
Yes, so I would suggest that there is a very nice musical program called My Body is My Body. You can type it on YouTube, okay? It's got it in many languages, including English, Hindi, and many languages. Through songs, without anything else, just through songs, it tells you that what is acceptable and what is not. you could probably start by showing your child this, because sometimes, you know, you can't have these serious talks and the child is not listening then to you. But through music, because that's the medium children love, show it to them. And then you can tell them, you know, I was telling you about this, that you don't let anyone touch you. This is what I mean. Don't let them touch you in your the bikini places, in your private places, all this. You can open up and then tell the child. You will have a point to start.
So to all my viewers out there, whether it's a parent, teacher or schools, we all have equal responsibility of educating a child, because child abuse has severe psychological issues which remains as injuries for life. It actually affects their marital lives also. Their going forward, their physical intimacy is also affected. You know, it's not only about sexual abuse. There are other types of abuses also which happens. But and the very shocking thing, as we discuss right now, it happens by inside the family environment. So it's very sad that even in family, the child is not safe. It's high time that we educate them. So thank you so much, ma'am. It was an absolutely insightful discussion with you. And to all my viewers, do check this song, My Body is My Body, and educate your child to on good touch and bad touch. Thank you so much, ma'am. I'm sure it will be equally insightful for my viewers also. Thank you for your time. It was really wonderful to have you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Ms. Seema. Thank you for having me here on this platform. And thank you for all the lovely questions that you gave me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Pleasure is all ours, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.